Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, and we welcome you all for the national webinar on open educational resources. Before we start, we would like to bring to your notice a few instructions. There will be a question answer session after resource person's speech, so please do post your questions in the chat box. The feedback link will be posted in the chat box after resource person's speech. After you fill the feedback form and submit, you will receive your e-certificates within a week or so. So please do fill all the details neatly and correctly so that it will be useful for us to give the correct certificates. Thank you. We shall now get on into the webinar. Gaining knowledge is the first step to wisdom. Sharing it is the first step to humanity. On this special day, on behalf of Nazareth College of Education for Women, I welcome you all for the national webinar on Open Educational Resources, Pathway to Democratize Higher Education. We shall now start this program with Tamil Thai Valthu. Okay. Prayer is asking God to align ourselves with His will, rather than asking him to be aligned with us. Now I request Miss Matilda, our student, to lead us in prayer for the blessing of this webinar.
Thank you, ma'am. Let's pray. Our loving Father in heaven, we come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you for this wonderful day, Lord. We thank you for food, shelter, and health you have given us, Lord. Especially, we thank you for protecting us from the impact of the coronavirus. We invite your holy presence now, Master. As 1 Peter 5:7 says, cast all your anxiety on God, because he cares for you. Likewise, we surrender this national webinar into your mighty hands, Lord. We pray for the speaker, bless her, and strengthen her, Master. We also pray for every dignified person who have joined with us in this national webinar through this application, Master. Make this webinar fruitful for them, Master. May there be no technical or internet.
Thank you, Matilda. Gratitude is twofold: love coming to visit us, and love running out to greet and welcome our guest. Now, I humbly request our respected principal, Dr. Golden Kishan, to welcome our resource person as well as the participants.
Good morning and a warm welcome to all the participants who are with us today to make this day a meaningful one. I welcome the coordinator, Dr. Sujata, and all my dear learning faculty and students who are behind the scene to make this day an effective one. My special thanks and welcome goes to the technical team who has put their effort to bring out the webinar successfully. It is a special morning for us today because we are going to get to know about the open educational resources, pathway to democratize higher education. It is said that no thoughts are our own. You will be surprised that not a single thought is our own. All are from other sources. All are borrowed and dumped by others on us. Sow a thought, you will reap an action. Sow an act, you will reap a habit. Sow a habit, you will reap a character. So let us make a habit on relying on open educational resource and make it a pathway in to have our own thoughts and feelings. I welcome our honorable resource person, Dr. Jyoti Bhavani, Associate Professor, Center for Educational Studies, Indian Institute of Education, Pune, to enlighten us on open educational resources. On behalf of the management, faculty, principal, staff, I welcome you all for this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. A dream written down, a dream written down with a date becomes a goal. A goal broken down into steps becomes a plan. A plan backed by action makes your dreams come true. Now I request Dr. Sujata, Assistant Professor of Physical Science, to highlight about the objectives of this webinar.
Good morning to all. Welcome to the National Webinar on Open Educational Resources, Pathway to Democratize Higher Education. Objectives are not commands, they are commitments. Without goals and plans to reach them, you are like a ship that has set sail with no destination. I take immense pleasure in highlighting the objectives framed for this webinar. To orient teachers on the concept of open educational resources, to help teachers and students understand the significance of open educational resources for democratization of higher education, to develop awareness among the teachers regarding copyright and different forms of licenses, to facilitate teachers to develop open educational resources to enhance teaching and learning process, to inform teachers on the different open educational initiatives introduced in our country. Thank you, one and all. Wish you all a wonderful day. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Happiness is knowing about great people and working with them. Now I request Mrs. Charlotte, Assistant Professor of English, to introduce our resource person, Dr. Jyoti Bhavani.
A very good morning and a warm welcome to everyone present at this webinar. I find immense pleasure in introducing our guest speaker, Dr. Jyoti Bhavani, Associate Professor, Center for Educational Studies, Indian Institute of Education, Pune, Maharashtra. She has also served in Indian Institute of Education as lecturer from 2000 to 2011. She has done her doctorate in education in the University of Mysore, and now she guides many MPhil and PhD scholars. Being an active researcher and an accomplished writer, she has authored 2 books, several articles, and contributed in many institutional and research publications. With 17 years of teaching experience for MPhil students and a lot of experience in online teaching and exchange programs, she has contributed a lot in e-learning curriculum development, in planning and development of e-modules. Adding to her credentials, in 2010, she has been awarded for the best research paper entitled online education mode to promote learner autonomy in a state-level seminar, Maharashtra. She was also a nominee for Dr. Rabindra Dev Award in 2010, has received the Erasmus Mundus Scholarship in 2012, Fulbright Fellowship during 2009 to 2009, Fulbright Fellowship during 2008 and 9. Above all, she has been awarded a gold medal for presenting the best paper entitled How and Why on Online Education, Perception of First Generation Learner in India at Symbiosis International Conference on Open and Distance Learning in the year 2011. We have an apt person to talk on today's topic. With an eager mind to learn and a thirst for knowledge, on behalf of the management, staff and students of Nazareth College of Education for Women, I'm absolutely delighted in presenting Dr. Jyoti Bhavani as the guest speaker for today's webinar. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, ma'am. Knowledge and positivity are the two things that increases on sharing. So now shall increase our knowledge on open educational resources. I now hand over the session to our resource person, Dr. Jyoti Bhavani. Ma'am, please, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. I am humbled to be here for this national seminar. And it's an honor to be invited by the Nazareth College of Education, Avdi. I would like to tell the audience, Avdi is close to my heart because this is a place where I've completed my school education. And now I'm currently at the Indian Institute of Education, Pune. The topic that I'm going to speak today is on open educational resources, pathway to democratize higher education. Education, as you all know, is very important for the development of an individual as well as the complete economic development of a country. But if you look at education from the ancient times, you know, earlier it was always a privileged identity. I mean, in fact, only a few had access to education. Initially, it was being offered by institutions like church and temples. So a very small group of communities only had access to education, but subsequently it did become open and open for the public. Maybe that is the reason if you see that we had come out with a lot of, our constitution had come out with Article 45 of Directive Principles of State Policy. We have the 86th Amendment, which makes education as a fundamental right. Which is, then we have the Right to Education Act 2009, which says free and compulsory education up to the age of 14. So these are a lot of legal and also constitutional initiatives were taken by the government to ensure that education was free, universal and public. But if you actually see, as time has gone by, we really need to question, is actually education a fundamental right? Is it free in true sense? Is it universal in true sense, or is it public in true sense? Public here I meant is whether it is a government enterprise or it is a private enterprise. In other words, is education really open or closed? If we say education is open, free, right, and universal, why is that only the boys, they send boys to the private schools, whereas the girls to the government schools? They send boys, they invest on the education of boys, but they do not invest on the education of girls. Why is there a stratification in the educational opportunities? Why do we have different kinds of schools? Why do we have a government school? Why do we have a private school? Why do we have international schools? So is there a differentiation coming up? Why are there caste differences? Why are the marginalized communities even today are unable to access education, free education? And why is the low socioeconomic status communities, why do they opt for public, the government school institutions? Why cannot they afford the private school education? I think these are a lot of questions that really need to ponder around us as educationists, as citizens, as the stakeholders, that is, when we speak of education, is education truly free and compulsory? Now, looking at, of course, now with the after the industrial revolution, you know that all of us have gone into a technological era. That is, where a lot of technologies have come into, and so internet has become accessible. With the internet became accessible, I'm sure all of you also know that there are a lot of benefits of internet, you know. Knowledge-based societies, they have facilitated in developing knowledge-based societies. We have formed learning communities. Resources are accessible to everyone who has access to internet. You have the freedom to browse through the internet, look out for the information you want to. It could be recipes, it could be any kind of content, it could be about universities, it could be about syllabus, curriculum. So it's almost an open platform for the entire public in the globe to have access to information. To some extent, it does imply that there is some level of a democratic platform where there it doesn't differentiate between people or caste and class. Internet, of course, with the condition that you have access to internet. Now, with the smartphones, you know that all of you have smartphones, so you have access to internet. But the whole idea that comes about this complete internet information age is the new economy that has emerged in the country as well as in the world, that is the liberalization, privatization, and globalization. You know that we are moving now towards an age of capitalism, where an economic and the political system in which a country or a trade of industry is controlled by private owners rather than by the state. So this is where, again, we need to come back to the question, like we come back to square one, that is education still a privilege, or is it limited, or is it at a, does it come at a cost? So the whole question rises again with, do we actually have a universal access to education? Ideally, you are supposed to have universal access, but in reality, yes or no? And do you have universal access to knowledge? So I think you really need to introspect the paradox of education. When we say, is it right, or is it actually a privilege? Is it public, or is it private? Now here I'm trying to contemplate and take you to a complete discourse of why I am trying to question this whole scenario as, is education actually universal, or is knowledge universal, or is knowledge universal, or is information universal? All of you, many of you must have come across, have experienced, like while you're searching for articles in the web, or when you're trying to seek admission, the best schools of higher education, like you want, I think everyone aspires to be associated with the best university or the best college in your area. And also you also want to have access to content or knowledge, which you think is of a very high quality. Or also sometimes as teachers, you want to adopt schools, tools or ideas which are there on the internet. But truly, is it a free access? Do you think so? If you look at the first barrier that comes when you get into internet or browse through the internet is you have to be proficient in English by and large. Although resources have come in the other languages, but still, you know that if you want to take, since this particular seminar is focusing on higher education, you know that if you're trying to do research, or if you want to have access to encyclopedias, or if you want access to research articles, by and large, they are available in English. They are not available in your mother tongue or in your regional language. So I think one of the biggest barriers of an open platform like the internet is language. I think English is, it's completely hegemonized. The complete knowledge portal, if you look into, is in the English language. So you really need to be proficient in English. The second instant I said about experience is when you're trying to access some kind of an article on the net. If you look into, this arrow mark which I show, red mark, you see there's a lock here. What does that lock imply? Is you do not have access to this particular article. I have enlarged the lock here, and you can see it's like this. This is what does it mean is, it is not an open access, it is closed. So you do not have an access to this article. This is similarly to the second article on growing up for early family life and education. That also is locked. So this implies that even when you go to the internet and when you try to access a particular research article, they are not always open. Similarly, if you look at why are they not open, because these articles are priced. There is a pricing for these articles. By and large, if they are an international organization and a publisher, then you know that you have to pay them in dollars. So you can see that the amount of economy it generates to even access an article in the internet. This is what it means by, see, this is the Sage publication. You can also see this. You have to pay $37 to access, and the lock means that you have no access until you invest on this article. So that again takes back to a question of whether education is free. No, if you really want quality education, you need to invest on it. There is some cost behind education. Similarly, another experience is when you're trying to access a content or an image on the internet. I know most of you go to Google Images and you see a lot of content. So this, I'm trying to access an image of a questionnaire, and many number of questionnaires, you can see pictures arise on the web page. But the question is, can you really pick them up? The question is that we all assume that, okay, this is, since I can see them, so I have an access to them, I can use them. But that is not true, because when you scroll down the web page, when ensure that whenever you go to an internet and when you are getting into a website or a web page, always scroll down to the web page, and there you will see terms of use. That means that page has put a certain condition to the viewer or a user to know what are the terms of use while using any content on that particular page. So this is an example of what actually do they mean by terms of use. If you look into this page, it says all content on the site, you know, it says you cannot, is protected by copyright, trademark, and unauthorized use. You are violating some laws, and it does not grant any express or implied permission to use. So you cannot copy, republish, frame, link, or download, or do anything from this page. So this is what it means by terms of use. That means all the content that is available on the net cannot be used by you, or even reused, or even shared by you for any kind of work on your own. See, this is another image I took. It's, you can see the paradox. It's an image of open educational resources, which actually philosophically it means open, but when you look down at the image, you see there's a small arrow mark. It says images may be subjected to copyright. That is what it says below. So even when you're trying to access any image on the internet, it says images may be subject to copyright. That means you do not have, it is not free, and you do not have an access. You need to go and look into the terms and conditions of this particular image. Similarly, this is another image. This is because all of us are very fond of looking into some kind of Venn diagrams or a mind map of a particular concept into the internet, so that you can think, okay, I can use them in my classroom, share with my students. But you need to see, even are you permitted to share this? Because in this particular diagram, if you see the arrow mark here below, it says copyright 2005 Asia Society. That implies that the Asia Society owns this particular picture. And see, before 2005, you can see, and I put it in enlarged form, that is a symbol for copyright. That is, it is owned or licensed by someone else. In other words, if you need to use this image, you have to take permission from the owner of this particular image. This is how it says that copyright symbol implies copyright. All rights are reserved by the owner of that particular developer, whoever develops the content or the website or the page, anything, image, all these are, if it has a C sign, it implies that it is copyright protected and it is not free for use. So if you have to use, you need to seek permission of the owner of that particular product. So this is what happens actually when you go into the internet. Internet is not free. The content on the internet is not free. They are owned by certain intellectual property rights. That's one. They come with a cost. Okay. even like articles sometimes, if you want the best research articles, they come with cost. Even if you want to enroll into a best online course, they come with a course, with a cost you have to invest. And also, other barrier, I said prerequisite, that you know that if you want to get admission in one of the best universities, you know that you have to score the highest. So it is not something that it is accessible only for everyone. It is only accessible to the gifted, the high achievers are accessible to the courses that are offered online. And lastly, you know, is a language, which I said is largely in English. Attempts are made, of course, to translate a lot of the content in the regional languages or develop content in regional language. But even today, because since the complete, we are completely colonized by the West, the knowledge is colonized by the West, you can see most of the knowledge that is existing in the internet or in the libraries are by and large in the language of English. And considering India, a very diverse society with more than 300 languages and more than you have more ethnic languages, dialects you have. So I think we need to understand what will happen to these people who are not fluent in English. How will they have access to a language? Overcoming these barriers. How do we overcome these barriers? To overcome these barriers, this is where the open educational resources come into hand. Okay. What is open education resources? This term is being coined by UNESCO in 2002. It emerged in 2002 in a global forum on open courseware, where it says they raised a concern that teaching learning materials should be published in the public domain, and is it possible to go away with the intellectual property license so that it enables free use, adaptation, and distribution of OERs, that is open education. And moreover, also, as Down says, that it should be of minimum or no cost to the customer, to the consumer or user of the resource. Open educational resources. Coming back, I'll speak a little bit about what is meant by OERs, that is open educational resources. Open educational resources is built around the same premise that access to quality education is viewed to be a right rather than privilege, for which educational content should be open or free. Okay, so this is what we mean by open educational resources. So we are coming back to the complete premise of education, whether it should be a right or whether it should be a privilege. But open education truly says that, it very strongly feels that education should be viewed as a right rather than a privilege, and hence it, the two premises of it is open and free. What is the philosophy of being open? The philosophy of being open actually emerged in the 20th century when actually a few community learning communities realized that whatever content is available generally in the universe, in the globe, it needs to be shared with people around rather than having it restricted and have the complete copyright on this part of content or knowledge. Why can't we have it open to people so that there are no economic barriers, and is it possible to improve access to a wider and a diverse social strata in the society? So that is where slowly this philosophy of being open emerged somewhere in the West. So the significance of open education is broaden access to learning, eliminate barriers of entry. And your barriers is something like it doesn't restrict to people of a low socioeconomic class. Open, it is free. So anyone, if you have an internet, you can have access. It can also make education affordable. That's it. Yeah. So it's not very costly. It's at a minimal cost. Wider participation. So more number of people, you know, because generally if we take up courses, only maximum 20 people can take up a particular course. You have restrictions in terms of number. So there's a limited number of people can enroll for a course. But when it's an open education course, you know, more number of people participate in a particular course or enroll for a particular course. And most important, introduce alternatives. What does it mean by alternate alternatives? Is, for example, if you develop a course, okay, somewhere, it is for a group of European students, but now you realize that that course is also relevant for Indian students. How do I contextualize that particular course? Because the example cited in that course developed by European developers will be more in the context of Europe. So is it possible to adapt it for an Indian context, that is for the Indian students or for an Indian situation? So that is where you come out with an alternative or a parallel kind of course. So this is what an open education permits educators is to come out with alternatives. So that is what. So if you ultimately see that, so you can reuse a particular course when you develop OERs, open education resources. You can adapt them, change according to your the profile of your learners, background of your learners, the age of your learners, and also. But you should also. It's very important to know that open resource always does not mean free. That is, it does not come without a cost. It also comes. It may not mean without a cost, because sometimes there is a minimal cost. And also second is, it does not mean it comes without conditions. So whenever there is a resource made, developed and published on the internet, there are certain conditions laid for utilizing that particular resource. Okay, so that is something very important. You should know that any resource accessible on the internet, you need to look whether that particular resource which you're trying to access, does it have some kind of a condition for utilization or for use, if I have to use it. So these resources, you can see that OERs, that is the open educational resources, are actually present in different forms, something like course materials. They are sometimes, you can find them in forms of modules, you can find in terms of syllabi, or you can find lectures, online lectures. They are in audio form, video form, or they are in terms of small notes or concept notes, or assignments, teaching learning materials, digital media, etc. So you can see that OERs can be presented in different forms. What is the significance of OER? Why are we speaking of OERs now? Now you know that the philosophy of open, but why do you think it is so important? I think very important is a strategic opportunity to improve quality. After the internet, you know that we have access to what is happening across the other side of the globe. And also we have now open access to the lectures given by experts across the other countries. Then I think that is why we need to have more of OERs. Sometimes we should not feel that only the Indians need experts from the West. Many times the West are also very keen to know what the Indian experts have to say, something about a social system in the country, the agriculture patterns in the country. So there is some kind of an exchange that is shared. So this is what an OER permits, is sharing of information, of knowledge between learning communities. Adapt, okay, if there is something that convinces a particular group of educators, then they'll say, okay, they'll seek permission and they'll try to adapt that for their own learning group, or improve the resources. If you think, okay, something else needs to be added, you can improve on that. And facilitate collaborative. I think that's very important, is facilitate collaborative work, knowledge sharing, capacity building. You know, collaborative work, I think the best example is Wikipedia. If you look into the Wikipedia, you know that the pages in the Wikipedia, mostly, they are not developed by only one person. You can go to any Wikipedia page and you can edit the page. So you can see it's a very collaborative work. Anyone across the globe can sign into, log into the Wikipedia. And if you feel that in a particular page, a particular fact is wrong, you can go and edit. So there is that collaborative kind of a work has been initiated because of the open education system. By and large, it would also mean democratic learning opportunities, of course, because you know that when you, for something like a Wikipedia, no one asks you what religion are you from, what caste are you from, which class are you from. So generally, you just have an identity as an educator who goes and edits and collaborates in the developing a learning material. So this is what is significance of OERs. Sorry. Advantages of OER. Now, as education institutions, why do you think education institutions should invest on OERs? I think this is a very important thing for, especially in a country like India, where you know that even today, when there is so much of digital divide, there are education inequalities, we still have a large section of children who do not have access to good education, quality education, something like children going to government schools, how do they have access to good quality education? Is it possible to link them to a website where they can have access to good quality? So that is what institutions, even higher education institutions, need to develop OERs. Why do you think they should develop? Because once you develop OERs, you should know that it is very economical, because if you there's a lot of open educational resources. There are open platforms where institutions can depend upon to develop a learning portal, and it helps to improve quality. You can also, by collaboration, by asking experts, not from your institution, from another institution, to contribute to your learning portal, make it flexible. That is, flexible makes make it very complex to your learners, children from your context, maybe if it's a tribal or a rural or a semi-urban or an urban context. And lastly is to make it personalized. Personalized, if a child wants to read a particular model, then he can always go at his own pace of completing a particular course or completing the module. So that is a very important advantage of OERs for. And I think institutions need to invest on OERs in this current information age. See, OERs always has its own advantages. You know, all of us, though I'm talking much about OERs, I'm talking positive about OERs, I'm speaking about significance, advantages, but you also know that there are few concerns about OERs, which you really need to take into cognizance while thinking of investing or using any OERs. Since OER is free to access, developed by anyone, the major question that arises while utilizing an OER is validation of the content. Do you think that the right person has developed that particular OER? Is the content provided on the website appropriate? Is it scientific? It is valid? Okay, so this is what you need to really question yourself while before accessing any kind of OER. So you need to validate. So this question of validation actually comes when OERs become accessible to everyone. Okay. Second is, whenever you're developing OERs, initial there is always a cost to it for the development of OER, because you need to develop on those technological tools which are platforms that you're trying to upload your content or develop your content. The other thing about OERs is why OERs is not very popular much is because I think there is very less awareness of OERs, that you can share content. But I think among educators, the biggest fear is sharing of content. You know, one person doesn't want to share his article or his knowledge with the other. This whole thing, I think you need to break that barrier. That educators need to come out of that, you know, it's a cocoon kind of a thing. You need to break that shell, and you need to break that cocoon and come out of that barrier to check whether you need to share that content. Lastly, of course, it is technology dependent. As you see that sometimes what happens is you rely on electricity, you rely on technology. If technologies do not work, then, and if electricity goes off, then you're completely stuck in your presentation or developing the OERs. So something like we had rains, I think if you know that in Mumbai, there was rains 2 days back, and the whole of city did not have power for almost a whole day. In fact, we also did not have the Vodafone network, phone network. So I could not access the internet for the whole day. So this is what happened. This is the whole concern about a drawback about OERs is they are technology dependent. The day technology doesn't support you, then you're left with nothing. So that is how is. So these are some of the disadvantages of OERs. Coming up to now, since I've been speaking of open educational resources, I've been speaking of openness, you need to say, what do you mean by this openness? When do I say a particular content available on the internet open? There are a couple of criteria you need to see, look out is, can I reuse that material? Can I redistribute? Like if a particular course is for a particular group of students, or if there's a content for, sometimes a university teacher puts up a content on the Wikipedia saying that this is for his course students, but can I take the same course material and redistribute it to my students? That is a question you need to answer. Can I remix? Can I add some more information on that content page? That is one. And the second is, can I rework? Rework is, can I change the complete format, maybe based on my background, socio-cultural background of my children, maybe pedagogy. I can change my style of presentation. If someone is present in terms of lectures, I would like to put in some activities. Can I change the lingual, that is, can I change the language if it is available in English? Can I translate them into Tamil, or can I translate into Hindi? And technological is, can I have it in different forms of technology? If the content is in the text form, can I have it in a digital form? Can I have it in an audio form, or can I have it as a video series? So this is what we mean by openness. Are you permitted to do these aspects? That also reflects the nature of openness of the content that is available as OER. This is where the whole, that is what, when I said, are you permitted? That is where you need to look at is, what is the license conditions applied to that material, to the particular resource? The best one is open, which has no rights at all. You know, that's generally the one kind of resource material which is present in the public domain. That is what is said. If your research is on the public domain, you have complete access and you can do whatever with you want with it. But at the other hand, you have is a corporate where all the rights of the resource is attained by the developer. So if you need to use that material, you have to take permission of the developer. But in between the open and the copyright, you have a partial right reserves. And this is what you need to know is by attribution. That is, you're trying to put some kind of conditions to your particular resource. I think this kind of resource, the center part, is something which educational institutions, teachers, teacher educators, even students need to look out. If you can develop resources under these kind of, and the first one is derivatives, permitted on a, whether you want derivatives, if you prepare a course material or a content or an image or a mind map, and if you say that derivatives are permitted means the particular mind map can be altered, a person can add some more components in that. If it is not permitted means the person who is using that particular has to take it exactly the same as it. The other one is commercial utilization, whether the product or the resource that you have developed is permitted. You can sell it, in the sense is, can you use it for a particular program where you charge fees by the student? So example, I'm trying to use a research article as a reading material for my students. So that becomes a commercial purpose because you're charging fees from your student for providing the material. Other is not permitted is, of course, where you cannot use it if you're charging fees from it. It has to be completely free. That means you can't get any income from that particular resource. And last one is distribution license is, can you distribute or can you not distribute? So that's the distribute is, can you distribute again to your own group of trainers, or can you not distribute? So this is a kind of, these are the three parameters generally are considered while you're trying to develop license. The question is, who developed this license? Actually, this license is developed by an organization called Creative Commons. This is an agency which actually facilitates you to develop license of your resources. Okay, if you look into the web and just Google for Creative Commons, you can see the kind of license that this particular agency offers. The first, as I said, where it is completely freedom for the content, is the public domain content, where you can build upon, you can build on that content and also then put it as you are the developer. So you can also claim later on under, so there is no restriction for the content that is available on the public domain. The next, the creative components, I said, comes out with a partial license. So this is what it says. First one, if you see by, it says by the owner. So that is, you acknowledge the owner. Second, it says is non-commercial. If there is no hyphen, then it is commercial purpose and non-commercial. And this is ND, the one with equal to, that is no derivatives. And the last one is which has a reverse C, that is share alike. These are the conditions generally laid by the Creative Commons. So this is a range of license offered by the Creative Commons. You start off with a public domain where the any resource that is available on the under the public domain is freely available. Okay, as you come down, the second one which has by this, it says that if you're using a resource, at least you need to acknowledge the developer. The next license is when you acknowledge the developer, you also, when you develop the content, it has to be the same license as by the developer. Next is you have next the license says that no derivatives. Next one says that it no you cannot use it for commercial purpose. Other one it says is no commercial use as well as share alike. Next last one is no derivatives, no commercial purpose. So this is a different range of conditions that are laced by licenses. And actually, next time when you go to the internet and you're looking down for any content on the web page, if you scroll down, you can see any one of these licenses generally in the content. Either they put them in these figures or they just put them in this text, BY-NC-SA. So if you look at, if you go downwards, the license restriction increases. That is, more restrictions are put for the product or the resource that is available on the internet. Now coming up to, so if you see that, as I said, in the these are the most accommodating licenses, that is, which are more towards an open education side, which generally says that you use my product, but just please acknowledge my content. The other one is, even if you're using my content, ensure that it is having the similar license as what I have had. So nothing but, so you are putting no restrictions. So such kind of resources with such kind of licenses can be used for commercial, non-commercial. You can come out with derivatives, you can change, alter the content, you can distribute. So these are the some of the open kind of licenses. Now we'll come to the very practical part. Now we've been speaking so much about OERs, the philosophy of being open, no? Why do you think OERs is important? What are the advantages? Okay, if it's OER, how do I know if a particular material is actually OER? How do I know if I can actually use them? If I have to use them, then I have to go down to see the license. I have to go see the terms of use. Can I use them or not for my lectures? Okay. Then the question comes, do we have OERs? Are there open access repositories in the world? Yes, there are. One of the ones is OpenCourseWare, which has been developed by MIT. You can see, if you just Google, it will take you to a web page. MIT has all its researchers' research findings. Articles are in the OpenCourseWare. You have Harvard also has is that's Dataverse. Then you have Cambridge, which has its Apollo, the repository. See, the website where the open access materials are generally available are called repositories. That is where the OERs are present. So the repository for Cambridge University is Apollo. We have TESS, which is for South Sub-Saharan Africa. They also have it for teachers and teacher educators. So they also have resources. You have the Lyndon University repository. You have ePrints. ISEC Bangalore has, it's called ePrints. You know, the IGNO has, IGNO is an open university. It has eGyan Kosh. The IITs have come together to form a repository. It's called the NPTEL. But largely, they offer courses in technology and engineering. The last one is NCRT, which is the National Repository for Open Educational Resources, which is also. These are the repositories developed by some of the institutions and universities across the world, including India. This is a... Sorry. This is a repository of the NCRT, which is called the NROER. That's the National Repository of Open Educational Resources. If you go into this, you can look into the resource library. It has a search window where you can type. Maybe teachers can access lesson plans. Maybe you can access images. You can access interactive, what are videos. So these are accessible on the NROERs. The other one is the IIT Bombay also has a DSpace, which is called DSpace, where it also have access to a lot of content. If you go to the, it's quite possible that most must be technological, but I think one should go and explore these websites to see other resources which are relevant for you, for your class, or also for the group of learners. I think it's very important for teachers and teacher educators to make use of these resources to improve their quality in teaching. NUPA, you know that is the National Institute of Educational Planning and Administration, which is a deemed university, which is situated in Delhi. Especially for people from the field of education, you should go to the NIPA website, and they have a link called, it's called Resources, Digital Archives of Occupation Documents. So you can see them. It has a complete record of, it's like a complete library, online library on the national documents, on national reports. It has DICE data. So a lot of, even it has research reports. These are available on the NUPA website. And if you're especially writing articles or publishing papers in education, I think this is one of the right sources to refer to in order to come out with a very good scientific and objective article or a paper. E-Pathshala, of course, you know, the government of, it is an initiative also taken by the government of Maharashtra, the government of India with the NCERT, which you can see clearly, it provides links like based on the stakeholder. If you're a student, you can access through here. If you're teachers, you can use this particular link. If you're educators, you can use this link, and if it is parents. So this E-Pathshala also, and all of you know that the NCERT has made textbooks, all its textbooks available online, which actually is a very great initiative taken by NCERT, because if you can't purchase, then you also have online textbooks. So this E-Pathshala is also a very good initiative taken by the government of India. Coming to something again abroad, is the Commonwealth of Learning. I'm sure most of you heard of Commonwealth of Learning. Is head office is in Canada. They have been doing a lot of work in education and development and health, especially in the developing countries and the underdeveloped countries. So lot of they also have a repository which is called OASIS. If you type OASIS and get into, you will go into the Commonwealth of Learning website. You know, they have a lot of material on different issues. You can see based on titles, and it's on research, country reports, and even corporate reports, where they have worked on countries like Africa and India and the other developing countries. And so most of the materials are more appropriate for people working in such countries. So even I think Indian, the educators and teachers from India can also have access to this particular website, because they also have a lot of resources on open and distance learning, which also has been one of the priority areas of the Commonwealth of Learning. Sorry. Okay. So coming to classification of resources, if you see, when I've been showing you some of the websites of the NCERT, the NROER, the National Repository of Open Educational Resources, the NUPA, if you see that the resources, when you go to the website, they are not generally present as resources. They are actually different types based on the philosophy of the institution or the purpose for which a particular OER has been, site has been developed by institution. These resources have been classified. So if you see, first one is something like the NCERT has come up with articles. They have classified the material resources as articles or courses, softwares, lessons, assignments. This, I am sharing this particular slide because this is for maybe guidelines to prospective investors or institutions who want to develop OERs. You can always think in this form. If I have to develop an OER repository for my institution, okay, what is the kind of how can I classify these resources? So this gives you an idea what kind of resources you can develop and classify in your platform of OER. So other one is format of text, audio, video, simulated situations. If you know, IIT Delhi has a very good simulated lab. It's called Virtual Labs. Please Google Virtual Labs and then you go to IIT Delhi. If you go to the Virtual Labs website, you can see that all the IITs and some of the institutions have contributed in developing simulations, especially in engineering and technology. You must use it because there are experiences being simulated, and I have recently used them. I saw the one which was on viscosity of fluids. It's a beautiful one where children would really love to, you know, it's something like simulated. You click the button and it pours the liquid into the apparatus and then you see what is happening. So it's a complete action of replay of what is likely to happen in the lab when you conduct that particular experiment. So you must look at the virtual labs, which has been now actually developed by IIT Delhi, but contributed by the other IITs and other technological institutions across the country. The other is domain in terms of skill, knowledge, creativity, difficulty, whatever it is. Other disciplines, of course, courses, you know, because some of the OERs, they are not as content. They are developed as courses, something like NPTEL, which I said is being contributed by the IITs. They generally have offered courses, which are open courses, which anyone can go and undertake. And of course, the advantage of those courses is you get a credit for your course. So that's actually one advantage. Maybe I'll speak later on what the government has spoken about open education. And you could also devise other classification. This is just a glimpse of classifications which are currently available. There could be more also. For example, look at the NCERT one. As I said, see, it has textbooks. They have classified as textbooks. They have classified as teaching instructions, learning outcomes, periodicals and journals. I think these are policies and documents. And last one is resources, which you see it's in audios, videos, interactive images, maps, and question banks. So this is the kind of a classification adopted by the NCERT. It's in the e-Pathshala website. Same thing, the National Repository of OERs. Here also, if you see on the left, which I put the arrow, you can see that the resources are classified as documents, interactives, that is simulations, audios, images, and videos. So this is how they have classified resources. So that's up to the user or the student who wants to use this particular, you can directly go on to search based on the kind of resource you want to have access to. Now, coming up to, so far I've been speaking of institutions investing on OERs. You've seen that, okay. Now, so far, many institutions have invested on developing OERs and publishing OERs, but ever since OER came and started getting a bit more, people became aware, even the research communities, that is the publications, have also taken initiatives to publish their research articles in an open platform. And this is, you know, Sage Open, Sage Journals is very one of the famous journals and well-known journals across the globe. This they have also come out with Sage Open, where all the articles under Sage Open journals are accessible. So you don't get a log there. It's an unlocked science journey, you can see. Similarly, the Spring Open also, at least Springer's publisher of journals, but Springer Open has now journals, which are articles which are open for access. In India, if you look at an open access journal in India, this is one of the best examples, which has been brought out by the IGNOU, which is called the Indian Journal of Open Learning. If you go to this particular journal, and go to a particular issue, you can see immediately, you can see there's a PDF sign. That means you can download the PDF of this particular access. So these are the initiatives, I think, slowly, even apart from institutions, even journals, that is the knowledge resources like publishing journals, publishers have taken a step forward rather than charging a price for every article. They also taken initiative to give them at a free cost. Coming up to content management tools, you know that, see, all institutions, you know that you have an LMS and you invest a lot on these LMS, because LMSs are very expensive, because they need to be maintained by a technical team. They need to be developed, you know, and even when you want to execute it, you always need a technical team to look if there are any kind of grievances or a technical slag. You need to take the help of a technician. So there is always some kind of an investment, which actually is not cheap. It's a huge amount of investment. So something like a Blackboard, it is an expensive LMS. I don't know what are the other ones, but there are a lot of, I'm sure as an education institution, you know that your institute website is using a particular kind of LMS, especially to have an interface between the students and the teachers, in terms of submission of assignments, in terms of admissions, in terms of enrollment, payment of fees, you know, declaration of results. So you need a platform. So that's where it's called a learning management system. But you can also think of, especially for OERs, you can always think of an open content management tool. And there are certain content management tools available where you need not pay. They are freely available and open access. They are like Sakai, Moodle. Moodle, I'm sure all of you must have heard of. There's a lot of training courses taking place, free courses on Moodle, how to use Moodle for teaching learning, how to run a course on Moodle. You know, Wiki Educator, as all of you are aware of Wiki Educator. Wiki Educator also is a very good tool where you can also publish your content on a Wiki Educator. It's just like Wikipedia. But you can hear the Wiki Educator, you own that particular page. So you are the educator in that particular content. WordPress, all of you who generally writes article or who generally have the, you know, flair for writing, some of you must be using a WordPress platform to share your thoughts and ideas with the public. Now that one is Google Sites. Google Sites is an open platform. You can always see, go to Google, just type Google Sites. If you have a Google account, that's a Gmail account, you can always open a Google site and open a website on your own, and which could also be used to share content with the others. So this is some of the illustration. This actually, I think, is of a Wikipedia page, which was used by a particular university in the US to share the course content of their particular, you can see University of Georgia. I looked out now, but I did not find, but I kept it because this is what I had access for a couple of years back. And I really want to show this is how a particular department has, you know, shared the content with the student. One of the best ways to share the content to the, it was open access, I could access it. So it's on the Wikipedia, but now I couldn't trace it back. But this is just an example to show how you can, how a content management system works. This is also a Google website, which I try to develop a training program for in-service teachers. It is just, this is actually what you say. It's a blueprint. It's not a working model. I'm not, but if you click, of course, at these links, it will take you to those pages. And this is made on a Google site platform. This is also another content management system. Okay. The third one, after completing OERs, I think you also, since we've spoken about resources, I thought we'll go a little bit ahead also and speak something about MOOCs, because MOOCs also is a derivative of open education resources. Okay, MOOCs, as you know, as a full form, is known as massive open online courses. You know, it's, I think all of you must have heard, because it's become so popular in the last couple of years. MOOCs, most of the institutions and advertising, and even the government of India has taken initiative to offer MOOCs courses for children in universities, you know, and platforms have been launched by the government to, you know, facilitate MOOC courses and encourage teachers also to develop MOOC courses and students to participate in MOOCs courses. Well, what is MOOCs? Just a small glimpse of MOOCs I will give in ahead of my presentation. MOOCs, actually, basically the whole objective of MOOCs is you are trying to offer this for a large audience, a course for increase the scalability. It is not limited to 50 or 100 students in a classroom. It can go beyond the classroom, so anywhere from the globe, and there is no time or place. There are no restrictions of time, place, anything for this. Okay. It's also an open source access software and low free, of course. Generally, it is free, of course. Few of them do access, do take a minimal fees, and they are generally offered on, it has to be offered online. The thing is, MOOCs are not always done by an institution. They've also been done by people. Individual professionals have also been experimenting with MOOCs. Institutes have also been offering, even corporate bodies have been offering MOOCs courses. Something like in the US, MOOCs, as you heard of, they started off, it started as a private enterprise by some like Udemy, Coursera, you've heard of edX. These are, they were offering online MOOC courses for massive audience, where students right from China and India and South America had access to the courses offered by these platforms. The whole question is, MOOCs, although universally it's an educative platform, sometimes it has a different purpose. Some of them are philanthropic, some are for corporate benefits, because something like edX and Coursera at Udemy. Ultimately, they were trying to find out, they were trying to select the best students for their industry. It was actually a way to filter the best for the industry, the IT industry. Sometimes it can be for lifelong learning. You can see some of the MOOCs offered by Commonwealth of Learning or by UNESCO. They are for lifelong learning. Some of revenue platforms, because you know some of the MOOC courses offered by the private entrepreneurs, institutions, they generally, for a certification, you have to pay some amount. So if you complete a MOOC course, you do not get a certificate until you pay some amount. So there is some kind of even a revenue generated through MOOCs, and there are other credentials also through MOOCs. So the whole question that rises here is, if there are revenue platforms, are they open? So that's another side that needs to be debated. So actually, if you see MOOCs across the globe, I mean in the world, it was initiated sometime in 2008. In India, it was initiated in 2012. And there was a professional from IIT who had initiated the first MOOC in India in 2012. Later on, IIT Bombay in 2013-14 came out with some couple of MOOCs. And then Commonwealth also, along with some of the institutions in India also, run the MOOCs. But today in India, this is the edX platform, if you know, which has been offering it has been offered by many of the universities. If you look below, a lot of universities which are using the edX platform to offer courses. Then you have the Coursera there also. You can see that these are also offered by Stanford and you can some of these courses. Okay, now coming up to in India, it's the UGC MOOCs. You know that the government in India, as I said, in 2014, we started having MOOCs in India, but the government of platform initiated the Swayam platform in 2017. Let me see the next, yes. In July 2017, the Swayam platform for MOOCs for online courses was initiated by the government of India. If you Google Swayam, it will take you to the platform and you can see a lot of institutions below. It's been run by IACTE, the IGNO, you have the IMA, NCRT, NIOS, Open School, NPTEL, UGC. So these courses are offered by the government of India. The advantage of the courses offered by the Swayam platform is you can transfer the credit from these courses to your under whatever course you are currently undertaking. So because sometimes there are some of the universities do provide the flexibility of a student to choose one particular course, maybe from any MOOCs, and then that credits, once he completes the course, the credits can be transferred to that particular program what he is undertaking. This is the NPTEL. See, NPTEL, as I said, has been run by the IITs. So below you can see the number of IITs that are taking over offering the NPTEL courses. This is, and there are a lot of guidelines and also timeline for these online courses. But and you see these are some of the conditions laid by the NPTEL for running the course. Okay, subject matters, course uploaded. So you can see the complete, there is certification courses, there is even NPTEL MOOCs, and who can undertake a course. This is the NPTEL platform. Okay. Now the whole question is, where are we heading to? Now you can know that we started off with, okay, initially education was for the privileged, then it became public, but then now again you realize that if you want quality education, there is a cost involved in it, you have to invest in education's quality. But then again, then the open education has come to counteract this barrier. So where if you want quality, you can use open education resources. So from content, we move to courses, open courses. And where are we heading? If you actually look into, we've also now, okay, just a minute. I forgot to put, actually, sorry. Where we're heading, you should also know that there is a university. I think the slide went by mistake at the back. Let me show you the slide. It's actually an OER university. This is the one. They have also established an open education resources university, wherein you can see a group of universities have come together. Okay. Where contributions for courses, developments of courses are made by individuals, by universities, by departments, by professionals who develop courses, and they are offered to OERU, where even universities can take courses from here and offer it in their university. So there you must go and see what is this. So you can imagine we have moved from content to courses, and now we have almost gone to a very formalized platform, that is a university, which is also not, it is, this university has been established quite some years back. It's still in process, but I think one needs to see where are we heading as a movement of open education started somewhere in the 20th century. We don't know where it's going to go ahead, because with the whole capitalism also coming up and the competitiveness increasing, will the open education resources survive this competitiveness, or is it going to get a different kind of legitimacy? I think this is something we need to look ahead, okay? And I just have, before I close down my lecture, and before we go down to closing, I have a last small activity for the listeners here who are being, please go to menti.com. And when you go to the menti.com website, you just type the code 962-4442. It will take to a page and it will ask you a question. Describe in one word OERs. Basically, I've spoken so much about OERs, the philosophy, the advantages, significance, what are the different platforms. There's something must be striking to you about OERs. Is it possible for you to come out with a single word on OERs? I want you to just go to this website and describe in one word OER and submit your response. And this is, thank you all for listening very, calmly to my lecture. I hope I was very clear, and I would like to thank the management of Nazareth College of Education, Navdi, and also the principal and the faculty and Sujata, who actually invited me to deliver this lecture. Let's see, I'll unshare and then I will take you to this. Yeah, I can see some responses coming. It says, let me see if I can share the screen. Stop screen and share screen. Can you see the screen which says where to present? Yeah, can you see the screen where I want people to just write one word, describe on OER. Yeah.
This is ma'am, it's already there in share screen, ma'am. You have stopped the screen now. Please share again, ma'am.
Now you can see.
No, ma'am.
Okay.
Give hello, ma'am.
I can't see an hello. Wait.
Okay.
Okay, anyway, I'll just read out the response that I've got according from the audience. It says equity, some says learning, some says global, some says informative, some says equity, okay? So this is how you would like to define OERs. Anyway, thank you so much for listening to me. Yeah, if there are any questions, I'm open to questions, yes.
Okay. Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. The session was really informative and educative. We have already got a good feedback from the participants, and we are happy that you have been with us, and thank you, ma'am. We shall now move on to the question answer session. We have about 5 questions that the participants have asked. We shall go one by one. The first question is from Sunita Rani. Is online teaching more effective than classroom teaching?
Okay. See, it's difficult to compare online with classroom because classroom has its own benefits in terms of face-to-face interaction that you can have a teacher. So there's always an emotional link. There's always an, you know, a social link which may not be available to an online. And as you know that online has its own barrier, something like a language barrier, a technological barrier. So it's difficult to compare, but you can always say that an online teaching can always supplement an a face-to-face classroom situation. It can add quality to a face-to-face situation.
Thank you, ma'am. We have, I hope the question has been answered. Next, the next question is, ma'am, what is the role of teachers to access in everyday teaching? Asked by Mrs. Devi Bhavani.
Okay. See, the role of teacher while accessing the OERs is, first thing you should know is when you're trying to search for an OER on the website, you have to first of all ensure that it is an OER, that is, it is an open access resource, that is one. I think awareness is very important. Second is identifying the right OER. As I said, one of the concerns of OER is validity. You have to validate whether the content is scientific and objective. It is not a very subjective content. And it is of a good quality. Basically, you need to infer the quality of the OER. And that is in terms of awareness, in terms of recognizing an OER, whether it has in terms of conditions. Third one is, as teacher, you should also develop OERs and try to publish it so that other teachers can also take advantage of the OERs developed by you. Because I think sharing of knowledge at this current age is very important for teachers, and as well as the student community. Even student communities can contribute for developing OERs.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. The third question is the value of open learning and regular mode of learning has some value in the mind of persons? This was asked by Anup Pandey.
I think there is a lot of debate going on online, certification done online and the certification done by face-to-face. I fully agree with you. There is a discrimination done because even today, when you take a course done by a distance education, that is by offered by an open and distance education universities, when the certificates are made, it mentions that you have done a course through an open distance mode. Actually, if you say that if the value is the same, then a certificate need not mention that you have completed the course. I think this is a debate which is still on, I think, and somewhere we need to realize that even open distance education courses have the same value as a face-to-face mode of program. It depends who's offering and how well is it offered using the right resources.
Thank you, ma'am. One more question. Why not use our education in practical life or daily use? Can we make our education to ideals to useful mode? This one was asked by Mahesh Sharma. You want me to read again, ma'am?
Could you please read again?
Why not use our education in practical life or daily use? Can we make our education to ideals and how to use it in useful mode?
I fully agree with you, Mahesh, because a lot of the content in today's education is actually very content-based and very theoretical. It is not related to practicals. You know, something like engineering, and also when you complete an engineering, you know that 70% of the content that you've learned in an engineering program actually is not of a very practical use, very small percent. That's because I think because it also depends on the kind of examinations we have been following. We've been following always the pencil, paper, pencil, paste paper pencil test, and we have also focused upon rote memory, lot of memorization. We have never tried to ask questions where children can share their ideas or discuss or give their views. I think that is a paradigm shift we need to take as educationists, and I am hoping that the new education policy which has come out will do something, because they have also insisted on higher order thinking, something like critical thinking and analytical skills. These are some of the skills emphasized in the policy. I think unless we emphasize on these, it is going to be a challenge for education to really have a complete shift or a turnover in the education system.
Thank you, ma'am. And the final one, we have one more question from Kalai Chelvi. Whether there is any parameter or indicator to understand the materials, notes, informations are correct based on quality and authentic contents that have been on the online.
Okay. This, as a teacher, I think to some extent you yourself, I have always considered teachers experts. So when you're looking into a research, to some extent, a teacher herself is able to estimate the resource what she's trying to use is valid or whether it is authentic. Because, and other thing also, you also need to see who, one is assessment made by the user itself, because especially if I think it's a teacher, because the teacher is the one who is going to share the resource with the student. It might be difficult with students to assess, but as a teacher. And second is, where are you accessing the resource from? You really need to go and look who is a developer, website, look into the website. And sometimes some are very popular, you can assure. And if it has a license, because if you see it as a Creative Commons license, then you know that it has come through a process of filtration. So somewhere there is a little bit of validation has taken place. So I think that is something, as a user, you also need to assess, and also who is a developer, and based how has the developer tried to publish this content? I think these are the things we need to take into view. Sometimes you can also show it to a peer group and get maybe views of others to check whether the content is valid on the particular website.
Thank you, ma'am. That's all for the question and answers. Thank you, ma'am, for patiently answering all the questions. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Now we shall move on to the next session. We have the feedback session. Good feedback is the key to improvement. So now I would like to call on Dr. Joseph Mary, visiting faculty of Anna University, to give her valuable feedback.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Like it was a very wonderful session, in fact. Normally, in teaching fraternity, I do not know to what extent they give more importance on OER, that is Open Education Resources. But this is the first time I have attended a lot of webinars. But I think this is the first webinar which I am attending on this topic. This topic considered to be very, very unique. In fact, I thank NASFED College for Women and the organizing team, in fact, and also the speaker, Jackie Bowner. It was a very good topic. In fact, many of us, even the teaching fraternity, many belong to this community, are not aware, what is this OER or what is the usage of it, or where to use or when to use. In fact, if you take this pandemic, after this pandemic, COVID-19, even after this, we do not know when we'll get out of this. So, I recently read an article which says that nearly 1.2 billion children are out of classroom after this pandemic hit. But still, the students are not left alone. They are being educated. We are very thankful to the technology. And in fact, this has changed education dramatically. Dramatically in the sense, the children are put up into e-learning. So I myself could see my son sitting in the classroom in online sessions since morning 9 to evening 6. So anyway, though they also face a lot of physical problems, I personally feel like this is this has extended a helping hand, and since the experts are not aware when we will get out of this pandemic, Okay, so here, as ma'am rightly said, as Jyoti ma'am rightly said, there is a sudden, I would say like there is a sudden shift away from the classroom. Not only in India, in many parts of our country, parts of the world. So here, how are we going to adjust with the system? Like, how are we going to bring, a connection between the world? So for that, OER is a best platform. In fact, like I would call it as a best platform, because now even if you take the institution, like from small to big institutions, started giving more importance on that. So if you take the different resources, to me, like when I was when I got into teaching, like in the last 10 years back, like I was very much familiar with MOOC. Only last 5 years I know like what is this MOOC. What is the importance of it? Now, every institute started developing its own resources. So I'm very thankful to Nazareth College and the organizing team, and also Jyoti Ma'am, like who has given us wonderful, it is one of the best decisions which I have come across in all the webinars which I have attended. Thank you, Ma'am. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Ma'am. Thank you, Ma'am. Thank you for the feedback. Your feedback means a lot to us. Thank you, Ma'am. Next, I would like to call on Ms. Nisi Kumar, Assistant Professor from St. Xavier's College, Mumbai. Ma'am.
Unmute yourself, ma'am. Nishi, ma'am. Nishi, ma'am.
Nishi, ma'am, we can't hear you speak. Unless you unmute, we will not be able to hear you.
Shall we move forward, ma'am?
The ma'am is calling her. Okay, might be we can have the vote of thanks and then we can have ma'am coming back. We can move on to vote of thanks. We must find time to stop and thank people who make difference in our lives. Now I request Mrs. Beena, Assistant Professor of Mathematics, to propose a vote of thanks.
Good morning to all those present here. Okay, thanks unto the Lord for his good and his mercy endureth forever. Psalmist says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus.
Hello.
Colossians chapter 4,
hello.
Verse 2. Yes.
Hello. Hello.
Nishi ma'am is online.
Hello. Hello. Hello, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Can you please?
Hello, ma'am.
Can you hear us, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, can you please just wait? No, vote of thanks is going on, and after that, you can give your feedback.
Okay.
Beena ma'am, please continue.
Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Colossians chapter 4, verse 2. At the outset, I thank my God Almighty for his gracious presence throughout this webinar. I extend my sincere thanks to Dr. Jyoti Bhavani, Associate Professor, Center of Educational Studies, Indian Institute of Education, Pune, for having consented to be the guest speaker for this webinar on the topic Open Educational Resources. Ma'am, your session was very informative, interactive, and very interesting too. on behalf of the management, principal and faculty of Nazareth College of Education for Women, we thank you, ma'am. I extend my heartfelt thanks to our beloved secretary, Mr. A. N. Henry Morris, and our principal, Mr. Dr. Golden Kisha, for their constant logistic support and encouragement in organizing this webinar. As rightly said by Helen Keller, alone we can do so little, together we can do much. We as a team of National College of Education for All Women always rocks. So I wish to express my gratitude to our organizing secretary, Dr. Sujata Shashikumar, for working with great dedication and commitment in organizing such a wonderful webinar. I thank all my colleagues who contributed their part towards the success of this webinar. My special thanks goes to the technical committee members, Mr. R. Harinath and Ms. Letha from Infosys Solutions, and Mrs. Gayatri from Nazareth College of Education for Women for the technical support for live streaming of this webinar. I also thank our beloved students, Ms. Sivlakshmi Harita and Ms. Pavitra Rao, for rendering their timely help in organizing this webinar. I thank all the participants who took their valuable and quality time to participate in this webinar. I once again thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Can we have now Nisi ma'am to give us the feedback? Ma'am, are you there on the line?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Please proceed.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. We can hear you. We can hear you, ma'am. Please proceed.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am. We can hear you. You can give us the feedback.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, Dr. Jyoti Bhavna, first of all, let me thank the organizers for inviting me for the webinar. It was a very informative webinar. Madam talked about OERs and she talked in detail about the OERs. She said the OERs, the language should be English and it should be based on internet. Although education is free, sometimes, you know, it may not be free if you need quality education, as one has to pay for certain intellectual property rights. So that has to be kept in mind. So she talked about the significance of OERs, how it can look after a number of students at the same time. Then she talked about the advantages of OERs. Like we can see that in the pandemic. This is the only way one could teach the students who are inside the house and they cannot go to schools and colleges. And then she talked about, you know, various ways in which you can share the OERs, and the licensing conditions of the OERs, what are the different types of licenses. And then she moved on to the open access repositories by many big institutions, e-pathshalas, and the classification of resources, and then she moved on to the MOOCs. Now in the MOOCs, she talked about, you know, government is taking a lot of interest in the massive open online courses, and then madam, you know, threw light on the MOOCs, you know, how they are improving the quality of education. So it was a very, very informative, talk. And thank you so much. We are really enlightened by whatever ma'am spoke. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the valuable feedback. It was great pleasure having all the participants for this webinar. Hope you had a very good session, and I hope you'll be benefited by this webinar. Thank you. We shall now all stand in reverence for the national anthem.
Have a nice day.